the university is supposed to be overseen by the Board of Regents. But what are the regents' interests? Are they whether some kid in Wayne County can get into the University of Michigan, or whether somebody from Escanaba can get in? No, they're probably the financial interests they're representing of the clients that they represent. So the University of Michigan basically is a financial institution, a financial enterprise, not an educational institution anymore. And we have to demand the same disclosure from the regents. Where are they getting the financing for their reelection campaign? What's going on? What clients does their law firm represent? Are there any conflicts of interest? Probably there are lots of them. Not one of the current regents is an educator. So why don't we have educators? Maybe, as Doug has suggested in the past, we ought to look at the entire restructuring of the regental situation in Michigan. Maybe we should have, like California, a state board of regents. And when you start looking at how powerful and what do these people do, under FOIA we found out that every home football game, the university and the regents give away 2,600 free football tickets. This is 6 or 7 times a year. Okay, that's the stadium only seats a little over 100,000. So you're talking about a percentage of it. Why are they giving those away? To buy goodwill. So you have the people who are supposed to be policing the university are kind of toothless. Now, you can go to higher levels. Okay, we have grants that are coming to the university from different federal agencies, perhaps expedited by local Congress people. Okay, they know what some of these grants are doing. They're training Chinese to build nuclear reactors. They're training Chinese to build electric cars and batteries. This is not in our interest. Why aren't we training kids from the Upper Peninsula, or kids from the Thumb, or kids from Traverse City, instead of training the Chinese? They're taking the places of American students that should be at the university.
Well, this is a public university. It's paid by our tax dollars.
That's right. The university gets a lot of public subsidies. They get the state appropriation. They don't pay property tax. They get all these grants. They get the overhead on the grants, which is a huge scandal in itself. It becomes a giant slush fund. Why? Now, during the campaign, Doug and I met with as many people running for office as we could, and we found that some were very interested in what we had to say and very concerned. Tim Walberg, who got elected, he was very sympathetic, very concerned. Tad McCotter, 2 or 3 years ago, called me up after an article appeared in Machine News about what was going on. He's concerned. But for years, I've been telling Carl Levin what's going on at the University of Michigan with absolutely no results at all. And same with John Dingell. We went to John Dingell and we said, hey, do you know what's happening? And we got a reply back a couple months ago that said, gee, there's not much I can do about what's going on. Well, you can quit supporting grants that go to the University of Michigan. There are a couple people. Representative Frank Wolf from Southern Virginia is very concerned about our national security and what's going on. Dana Rohrabacher from California, is concerned. And we all know that Darrell Issa is going to hold hearings on general incompetence in the government, and it would be my prayer that Darrell Issa would hold a hearing on what's happening at the University of Michigan. Within the parties, the regional candidates have to be meaningful. It's not simply a political payoff for political favors and raising money. It has to be people who are concerned with the educational system that's happening in Michigan. Okay, so maybe it's going to be up to the third parties to either influence the two major parties, which maybe isn't likely, or to run their own candidate themselves. Okay, and
for the Regency.
Yes, the third parties are going to have to run regional candidates, in order to take back the university, which belongs to us in the first place. And also, if you look at what's going on with the tuition under the new model of the university, well, it's almost become too expensive for a farm kid from the Thumb or an inner city kid to pay to go. But Mary Sue Coleman will tell you, oh, we have financial aid. But when you see financial aid, you have a very strong connection to the political establishment and not becoming a whistleblower at the university, or they're going to remove, okay, what you have financial aid. We really need, with regard to this sabotage, espionage, and potential traitors, okay, we need the Department of Justice to say, what's going on out at the University of Michigan, okay? I mean, I'm sure there's a grand jury permanently impaneled in the Eastern District of Michigan. Why don't we have the grand jury investigating the charges that are being made concerning the transfer of our technology and know-how? We know that this goes on occasion because occasionally we catch a Chinese spy at General Motors going through the dumpster or whatever, okay? So, but that's small peanuts compared to what's going on.
Well, I might speculate as to why we might not be getting the Department of Justice in there, because we have, I know personally, I've been to two different U.S. attorneys here in the Southeast District of Michigan and demanded grand jury investigations, only to have it, the door slammed in my face, and the courts are not, there is grand juries impaneled, and these courts will not allow you to get to them, a citizen like myself or yourself, and the U.S. attorney is not allowing, and they are the gatekeepers, and when they're not allowing us to get to a grand jury and we have no way to do it ourselves, then we've got a real problem on our hands here.
Well, Barbara McQuaid lives in Ann Arbor. She's an alumni of the university, but she certainly knows what's going on with regard to the Chinese, and I think it would be very appropriate for her to act on this problem. If it had been during the Cold War and it would concern Russians, there's no doubt that there would have been action.
Well, that sounds like a good invitation, Barbara McQuaid. I'm going to give you that challenge right now. And we have a lot more to talk about, so I know we're going to be coming back to the show with Dr. Kaufman and Dr. Smith. And we want to thank you, the viewer, and we'll see you next time.
Hi, everyone, and welcome to the final segment of the Power Corrupts Again interview series with Dr. William Kaufman and Dr. Douglas Smith, two retired University of Michigan professors who have for quite some time now been, along with numerous others from the University of Michigan, blowing the whistle on corruption in research, copyright, and patent ownership, and the selling out of America's security and job interest in America's top universities. So to serve the alternative interest of the university administration and corporate elite. It should be recognized by this viewing audience that Dr. Kaufman was an important participant in the arms race of the Cold War with the Soviet Union, working alongside military leaders in the secret development of advanced aeronautics, propulsion, and weaponry. In a recent interview that Dr. Kaufman did for journalists Vince Wade in Mr. Wade's documentary series titled Armed in Academia, Aiding the Arms Race, Aiding America's Decline. In the first of many episodes, which was titled China Milks Our Sacred Cows, Vince Wade reveals how tens of thousands of blue-collar and white-collar jobs have been lost in recent years, and that many of those jobs have gone to China. While Michigan continues to struggle economically, its premier university, the University of Michigan, is working hard to help China instead. Mr. Wade points out in his documentary that pro-American whistleblower Dr. Bill Kaufman is alarmed by what he sees in a massive infiltration of the university's College of Engineering by Chinese students intent on learning the innovative technology that keeps the United States well ahead of the rest of the world in military superiority. Recently, we had a delegation from Harbin Institute of Technology, which is closely associated with the Chinese ICBM factory. Again, ICBM stands for Intercontinental Ballistic Missiles. And the Harbin Institute is not just any university here on a humanitarian or cross-cultural visit. Harbin is the equivalent of our MIT. It is instrumentally connected to the People's Liberation Army and is institutionally part of the militarization of China. Dr. Kaufman stated that it was clear that this Chinese university delegation was here in Michigan looking for technology to enhance the fiberglass casings of their sea-launched ballistic missiles. The lighter the weight of the rocket casing, the heavier the weight of the missile warhead. These Chinese were over here with a specific interest in the technology that increases the range and lowers the air resistance of their ballistic missiles. What particularly bothered Dr. Kaufman was the University of Michigan people who invited this delegation, who minimally consisted of Chinese national Wei Shi, a multinational university professor that had long been awarded all types of security clearances by our American government and research universities for advanced research projects. She and others at the University of Michigan had to have known about Harbin University's ties with the military and the intent of this Chinese delegation. Yet the private interest of those at this Ann Arbor, Michigan University, for some reason, took greater precedence than the national interest of America's homeland security. As you recall, I have been conducting a studio interview with Dr. Bill Kaufman and Dr. Doug Smith. And in the last segment of Power Corrupts Again, we had some discussion about how the entrepreneurial ventures of our new Michigan governor, Rick Snyder, a graduate of the University of Michigan, fits into all this with his investment company, Ardesta, having partnered with another company, Decera, and having opened what Snyder has asserted to be only a small five-person sales office over in China. In the last segment, I discuss how the company Decera, founded by Rick Snyder and Chuck Nguyen, had formed partnerships with several other companies to market their MEMS oscillator technology to different end users. One of these companies was cited as being Vectron International, a subsidiary of Dover Corporation. Under the terms of their partnership, Decera offers up the patented product, the MEMS oscillator technology, while Vectron markets that technology for use in guidance missiles and smart munitions. In reviewing videos produced by Vince Wade's company, which I also spoke about in an earlier segment, I should bring attention to another important issue Mr. Wade brought up in his video, Chinese Espionage and the Michigan Election, as it pertains to another of Rick Snyder's private business ventures. It is that his investment firm, Ardesta, is a major investor in another communications tech firm called Neo Photonics, an optical network company at the forefront of the next generation of wireless communications. What is significant to note about this alliance, as reported by Vince Wade in his video, is that Neo Photonics is a major supplier to Huawei Technologies and ZTE, two Chinese companies widely regarded as two high-tech espionage fronts for the People's Liberation Army of Communist China. Here is a letter written to the United States Secretary of Treasury, the Director of National Intelligence, the Department of Commerce, and the General Services Administration, expressing the concerns of at least eight senators about the Chinese company Huawei. It is signed by John Kyle, Christopher Bond, Richard Shelby, James Inhofe, Jim Bunning, Jeff Sessions, Richard Burr, and Susan Collins, and copied to the Secretary of Defense, Robert Gates, the Secretary of Homeland Security, Janet Napolitano.